Welcome to American Reformed Church. It's good to be here this morning. I hope you all enjoyed the extra hour change this morning. Everyone go to bed on time last night? Yeah, some of you, yeah, a little bit. Man, it's been so good this morning. I was actually joking. I was like, man, with this extra time, you know, maybe we'll start church a little earlier. And I got my wish. But I'm glad we all could be here this morning. Got a few announcements as we gather here today. First is, today is International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. And so as we gather and worship here today, as part of our congregational prayer, we're going to be praying for our brothers and sisters throughout the world who are persecuted for their faith. The other announcement we have is after the service today, we have nominations for our elders and deacons within our church. For those of you who are members, we're going to have a brief moment after the, just stay in here after the service, real briefly, we'll fill out our nominations, and then we'll go out and have refreshments. And those who are with guests with us this morning, it'll only take a minute, but the good news is you get first in line for, we got some snacks and coffee and stuff. So if you're guests with us, while we quick do nominations, you get first dibs at all the goodies. So with that, I want to start our morning with a little pumpkin that someone gave me from church. And I'm sure you've heard this before, but I think it's a really nice saying about the Christian faith. You know, our faith is like a pumpkin. God washes the dirt off you. He removes all the yucky stuff. He carves a smiling face on you and puts his light in you for all the world to see. Isn't that good? With that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you that we can gather here today. God, we thank you for the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that our faith is like a pumpkin, Lord, that you wash us off, that you remove our sin and dirt, and you place the light of Christ within us. And so, God, I thank you for the joy it is in knowing you and the grace and fellowship we have in Jesus Christ, that we can gather in your grace, in your love, and in your fellowship. And so, Lord, may we not only today, but each and every day of our lives, continue to share in the joy of knowing Jesus Christ, knowing that through Christ our sins are forgiven, and we have the hope of eternal life to be with you even in heaven, that not even death can separate us from your love. And so, Lord, may your Spirit be upon us here today as we offer worship to you, that you are our Prince of Peace, and that you are holy, and you are the God that we worship. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Well, in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of Spirit, let us turn to the person to your right or next to you and say, I'm glad you're here. Although if we go right, we're all looking right, aren't we? So, and look to the person next to you and say, I'm glad you're here as well. All right, let's stand and greet one another. Man, I think pass. Oh, I'm on. Hey.
Let's say our call to worship together, which is from Psalm 18. I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I called to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies.
I will follow.
Please continue singing with us, hymn number 58, This Is My Father's World. Seated.
If you need to fix it, you can now. As we continue to worship the Lord, let us now go to our confessions of sins as we'll say it on the PowerPoint screen together. Let us pray to the Lord. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me. For your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he instructs sinners in the way. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. Relieve the troubles of my heart and bring me out of my distress. Consider my affliction and my trouble and forgive all my sins. Amen. Hear the good news of the gospel found in Acts 13 and Ephesians 1. Through Jesus Christ, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. In Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Believe this gospel and live in peace.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great. summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is God's faithfulness. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. At this time, we're going to continue to worship the Lord in the Word of God, and so I invite the children to come forward for this morning's children's message.
I heard good. Okay, good. We like that. So today, I had a thing all prepared and, well, sort of prepared, kind of. I didn't get everything done, so this morning I had to work on a different children's sermon. You know how sometimes you think you're going to get something done and then life just happens and you're too busy and it doesn't happen? That happens to me once in a while. So anyway, Pastor Tim is going to talk about Romans 5, 1 through 11 today. And as we do that, I want us to think about all the many blessings that we have. In fact, we have so many blessings that we can't even imagine all of them. Okay? So part of that is because Satan kind of tricks us a little bit. He gets us to think that we have to have everything right now. And that somehow we can't wait for the future, we can't think about things down the road or anything like that. We want what we want, and we want it right now. And that's not right, because we need to focus on what's happening right now, but we also need to look to the future, okay? And in order to get God's blessings, we need to listen to God's word, and we need to pray, and we need to try to do the right thing. So one of the blessings that we get if we believe in God and we trust in him is the gift of peace, okay? Now, I want you to imagine something with me. We're going to imagine. We grown-ups would say the word hypothetical, but that's kind of a big word. It's not a real situation. I'm sure it's never happened to any of you. Excuse me. But imagine that your mom has just made a plate of goodies. It's your very favorite, whatever that is, if it's chocolate chip cookies or Rice Krispie treats or whatever it is. So there's this big plate sitting on the table, and you're thinking, oh, this is awesome. This is the best ever. Okay, so mom just gently says, those are for something special. Don't eat them. Okay? So you don't get what you want right now. Right? Okay. So eventually, mom goes about her business, does something else, and pretty soon, you're thinking, those look really, really good. If I took just one, she won't notice. I'll rearrange them a little bit. She'll never see it. So you go ahead and have one. And then you start feeling bad about it. Maybe I shouldn't have done that. She did say I shouldn't. Now what do I do? You're waiting. Well, nobody says anything for a while, so you think, well, maybe it wasn't that big a deal. But then mom looks at him, starts counting them. She kind of looks around, and she looks directly at you. And right away, you go, did you have one, she says? Well, you're not going to lie. You're going to tell the truth. And you say, yeah, I ate one. And then she says, well, you know, I guess it's okay you have one now, because I was making these for treats for something special at school tomorrow. But now there's one less, and I don't have time to make more, so I guess when you go to school tomorrow and you have your special treats, everyone else gets one except you, because you've already had yours, right? But the best news ever is that mom still loves you. She still thinks you're great. She's excited to have you as you're her child, and she loves you more than anything, and that, you know, you learned a valuable lesson here. You learned that sometimes you have to wait. And it's okay, right? So from that, we can take a few different things, and that's about peace. You were at peace before you ate the treat, right? And then after mom forgave you, you got peace again, right? Because you realized that you did something wrong. So peace is a good thing, and we're no longer separated from God because of his love for us. So just like your mom loves you, you're no longer separated from her thinking, oh, I did something bad and now I'm going to get in trouble. But now your mom has shown you that she still loves you. And then there's hope, okay? Hope is awesome because that means no matter how bad things get, there's something to look forward to. So even though you might have gotten in trouble for eating that treat or whatever, you didn't get into big trouble. I'm not saying you won't. If mom's really, you know, excited about these treats for everybody and then there's one missing after she told you not to take one, yeah, there might still be some consequences. But that's okay because you always have hope that it's going to be forgiven. And then there's character. That's kind of a hard word for us to figure out right now when we're your age. But what character is, that is something that God does. He gives us difficulties. When you become a Christian, everything's not perfect. You still have problems. You still do wrong things, and bad things can happen to good people and all that. But it means that God still loves you, and he puts you through these difficulties so you can learn something. So you learn to listen to your mom and not take that treat. Okay? And then there's also assurance of God's love. And it says in the Bible that we're to rejoice in spite of our sufferings. Now, that seems kind of crazy to be excited about suffering, right? Or something bad happening. It's hard for us to do that. But because God loves us so very, very much, and we can experience that love we have before, so we know he's full of love, and we know that he's going to forgive us and send the Holy Spirit to help us. You know, God died for us. It says in the Bible he died for the ungodly. What does ungodly mean? Yeah, it's kind of hard to think about it, but what it means is people who don't believe in God, people who don't follow his rules, they don't read the Bible, they don't pray, they don't think about other people first, that kind of thing. And he died for them. But he died for us, too, because after all, we're all sinners. We all make mistakes. So that's something that we need to remember, is that God loved us so much that he died on the cross for us, and that, you know, we never earned it in the first place. So all we can do is give God all the praise, all the glory. Okay? So remember that. When you're thinking about maybe doing something you shouldn't, first of all, think, I probably better not do that because there might be consequences. But always remember that parents love you no matter what, and so does God. Okay? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just thank you so much that you were willing to die on the cross for our sins. You did nothing wrong, Lord, your entire life, and you spent it amongst people just like we do. And we just thank you so much that there is nothing, in, as far as the east is from the west, and that's a long ways if you think about that, Lord, we cannot go anywhere without experiencing your love. And Lord, we just thank you so much for that. And we ask you to forgive us our sins, and we ask you to be with us and help us to do a better job the next time, Lord. We just love you so much, and we appreciate the love that you give to us. In your name we pray, amen. Okay, we can go back.
Thank you, Corey, for sharing the children's message with us this morning. At this time, let's turn to Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, as we continue studying God's word through the book of Romans. And today, we're going to be looking at how we are justified by Jesus Christ, which means being made right before God and before others because of what Christ has done for us. And so, we're on Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. And as we open God's word, let's open up our hearts and our minds to what God has to say to us today. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the grace given to us in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That though we are not perfect, that none of us are righteous, Christ came and died on the cross to reconcile us to you and to one another. And so, Lord, I just pray now today that we can give hope in the glory of the gospel, give praise to you and boast in the Lord of the joy of what Jesus has done for us. And so, Lord, as we open up your word, we just pray that you open up our hearts and our minds to what you would like to speak to us, both individually and corporately as a church, that you may be proclaimed in the good news of Jesus Christ. In your name we pray, amen. Hear the word of the Lord beginning in verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is God's holy and inspired word. Brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, through faith in Jesus Christ, we are justified before God. We are made right, not because we are perfect, not because we do all the right things, but because God so loved us that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, that we may be reconciled to God and be declared righteous in his sight. And brothers and sisters in Christ, that gives us reason to boast and to celebrate, not because we are perfect, but because of what God has done for us, that we are reconciled in Jesus Christ. You see, to be justified in Jesus Christ makes us stronger in faith. It makes us stronger to endure when times get tough. Why? Because we know that God has reconciled us with him. But as we look at the world, sometimes the world doesn't see it this way. Sometimes the world looks at Christianity and thinks, you know, as a religion, as our faith, as we put our trust in God, sometimes maybe the world thinks that makes us weaker. Why? Because the world wants to think that maybe people who have a little axe to grind or people who are trying to prove themselves sometimes have a little bit more edge to them than someone else. And sometimes we believe that lie as well, thinking, well, if I don't allow myself to receive grace, if I'm hard on myself and I'm hard on others, maybe that'll make me a tougher person. A couple years ago, just to explain where I'm getting at with this, a couple years ago, we watched a movie called Woodlawn here at the church. It was about a high school in Woodlawn, Alabama, where they were dealing with segregation issues and integration into the high school. And the story goes, there was a chaplain there at the time, and the town and the football team was struggling a little bit because of all these issues going on. And a chaplain came in and was sharing about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And at first, the football coach didn't know what to think about Christianity. Why? Because he didn't want his players soft. He didn't want his players to be loving, so to speak. He wanted football players that were a little rough around the edges, right? Little football players having to prove themselves, right? Prove themselves to others, prove themselves their worth, prove themselves in their community. But as we see in this movie, and based on the true story, what we see is that the opposite happened. That when the players came to faith in Jesus Christ, they didn't become soft, but they became stronger competitors. And why did they become stronger competitors? Because they no longer had to prove themselves before God or before others, but receive God's grace. And they were now living by not out of fear, but out of faith to a higher purpose that God had given them. That they are living out of faith, that they are serving the Lord. And because of it, that they were serving the Lord, they worked even harder to the best of their ability to give the glory of God. You see, as we look at that movie, where the coach once thought that by living in grace, it made them pushovers. The coach realized that by living in grace, it made them stronger individuals. Why? Because they no longer had to try to prove themselves and worry about it, but rather they could live and serve for the glory of God and give it their all. And as I think about that message, as we think about that movie, I think all of us live that same way as well. I think all of us feel like grace is a concept that's hard for us to accept. Why? Because I think in all of us, there's a tendency that you and I want to prove myself, right? I want to prove my worth to other people. I want to prove my worth to God, that I am this valuable person. And I want to prove myself to other people. And we think that if we rely on God's grace, that somehow that'll make us softer, that somehow we're cheating in a way, that we're not able to have that edge that we used to have. But the reality of the gospel is this, that we've been looking at in God's word. None of us can obtain that unobtainable goal. None of us can live righteously enough. None of us can reach high enough or do enough to merit God's, where God says, yes, you are so good, you are so accomplished that, wow, I'm going to bless you because you have earned this. Because if we're trying to earn the approval of God, of other people, based on our merits, by what we're trying to prove ourselves, we're just going to be frustrated and fall short time and time again. Because as we see in God's word, we can't justify ourselves. All of us are going to screw up. And so as we try to prove ourselves, as we try to justify ourselves by our own righteousness, we're going to find a mess in all things. Why? Because A, we're going to be hard on ourselves and try to have an expectation that we'll never live up to, and we'll be discouraging and put ourselves down. And second, we're going to have a high, impossible expectation of other people as well. And that was what was happening in the movie Woodlawn, as they were fighting, trying to prove themselves, prove their worth. But it wasn't until they recognized the grace and justification of God in Jesus Christ that the team was finally able to be strong. And so how do we be strong in the Lord? How do we give up our control, of trying to control our lives, trying to prove ourselves to God. Because when we do, we're just going to keep falling short time and time again. Because none of us are righteous, and we're going to learn that none of us are worthy to the glory of God. All of us have sinned and fall short of God's glory. But as we look at our strength, if we want to be strong as individuals, strong in our community, strong in our family, it's not because of our strength in ourselves. It's not because of our toughness. But our strength is in the grace of God. What does the scripture say for us today? We are justified by Jesus Christ. That means we are made right before God. And how are we made right before God? Did God get rid of all the rules and say, I'm going to let this all slide? No, we are made right before God because Jesus Christ was so tough, so strong, that Christ came down and died on the cross for your sins. Christ came on the cross and died for my sins. Christ didn't move away from the sin of the world, but Christ took the sin of the world head on and willingly laid down his life on the cross for our sins. We worship a strong and mighty God. We worship a strong and mighty Savior, where Jesus Christ did not succumb to temptation, but spoke the truth freely and spoke it to those who didn't approve of it. And Christ willingly went all the way to the cross for our sins. And Christ did this. Why? Not for because of our righteousness, because rarely will people die for a righteous person, right? But what did it say? While we were still sinners, Christ died on the cross for us. And so if you're thinking about toughness, if you're thinking about toughness of grace, look to Jesus Christ who shed his blood on the cross for us. Christ was willing to die for us. And if that isn't tough, I don't know what is. And because of the blood of Jesus Christ, we stand forgiven. We can now stand before God, the word says. We don't lay down. We don't put our head in shame, but we stand before God and we boast in the Lord. Why? Because of the grace of God in Jesus Christ. And that is where our true strength lies. It's not in trying to prove our toughness or prove ourselves to God or to other people, because time and time again, as we see in the world, we fall short. And time again, we see the world, even if we do prove ourselves, even if you're the president of the United States of America, people will still not be impressed. So if you're trying to impress people, it's not going to happen. Our toughness, our strength is in the power and grace of Jesus Christ, that I can stand here today, that you can stand here today with your head held high and boast in the Lord and Jesus Christ. That yes, people will acknowledge and see that yes, I am not perfect. I am a sinner. That you are a sinner. You make mistakes. And as soon as we can acknowledge that truth, as we can live in that truth, then we can stand with our head tall and say, yes, I did sin. Yes, I did make a mistake. But by the grace of Jesus Christ, I am still here. I am not cowering away. I'm not living in the shadows anymore. I'm not living in the darkness. But because of Jesus Christ, I can stand in the light and say, I am forgiven because Christ died for me. And you too are forgiven if you put your faith and trust in him. And brothers and sisters in Christ, when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, and we recognize that our strength is found in him, we know that if Christ is willing to die for our sins, then not even death can separate us from the love of God, that I can face whatever comes my way because of Jesus Christ. And it's because of that we live in peace. We live in peace through what Jesus Christ did in reconciling us with God. You know, as we look at our lives and the day-to-day things, things happen. Things are going to happen tomorrow. And the question is not whether it'll happen or not, but the question is, do you have peace about it? Because things will happen tomorrow, things will happen next week, but the peace that we have in knowing is that we can either worry about things that need to get done and will have to get done or not get done, or can we confront them in the peace of knowing that because we are forgiven, we can take things head on. In other words, why waste all of our energy if we're thinking about strength? Why waste all of our energy worrying about things that we can and cannot control when we can live in the peace of knowing God? And so that is the strength that we have. Instead of sapping our energy about worry, but live in the peace of knowing that we have already been made right before God. And so lastly, as we look at all of this, as we learn that we are justified in Jesus Christ, that we don't have to prove anything to anyone or anyone because God proved it to us through his son, Jesus Christ, and his grace, that we are justified before God. I want to end with this thought then. How do we tackle the world? How do we tackle things? Does it mean that as Christians, now that we've accepted God's grace, we just remove ourselves from the world? No. We live in the hope of glory. I'm going to go back here a second to read our scripture for us today, because the Apostle Paul gives us a list, and I want to say this for us today, beginning and end of verse 2. And we boast in the hope of glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our suffering, because we know that sufferings produce perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. What that means is this. We hope in the glory in our sufferings. As Christians, because Christ suffered for us and died for us, we're not afraid of suffering. We're not afraid of tackling issues head on. We're not afraid of what can come in this world. Why? Because we're already victors in Jesus Christ. We're already been given grace and forgiveness, and Christ died for us. And so the hope of the glory that we have is that in the face of suffering, we can take it head on. Why? Because of the hope of glory that God has put in us. What does it say? God has poured out his spirit of love within us and is overflowing, that we can persevere and have character even amidst of our trials. And that, brothers and sisters in Christ, is true strength. In the midst of adversity, and in the midst of being threatened, in the midst of the challenges that come our way, that we can tackle it head on. Why? Because we have been justified in Jesus Christ, that we can stand before God and stand before others, and we put our hope and trust in him. And so we compete, using the football analogy, we compete to the best of our ability. Why? Not out of a spirit of holding a grudge or anger, but because of a great joy and love and the passion that God has given us. We do our work with diligence. Why? And we persevere. Why? Because of the outpouring of God's love in our hearts. And so that is how we are justified in Jesus Christ. That is what the gospel looks like for us, as we look at how we now have peace through Jesus Christ. As Christians, we live our life differently, that we live our life in strength, that we stand strong, not because we're perfect, but because it first starts in our confession of our sins, to acknowledge that we repent before our sins before God, that we are forgiven in Jesus Christ, who was raised from the grave. And if God raised Jesus from the grave, who was willing to die on the cross for our sins, then what in the world is standing in our way from not living out in faith in all times and all circumstances? So brothers and sisters in Christ, today I tell you, boast in the Lord. We will not be put to shame. There is no shame in our life. Why? Because Christ took the shame of himself on the cross. But as believers in Jesus Christ, we can stand strong before the Lord, because we know that Christ, while we were still sinners, he died for us, that we can be before God. And so let us stand in strength, being justified Christ. Let us live in peace. And let us know that in all circumstances, God has poured out his love for us. That in all that we do it all for the glory of God. Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are justified through faith in Jesus Christ. God, our justification is not in our own selves. That we can't justify ourselves for being this great person, this righteous person, because all of us are sinners, as we heard, and fall short of the glory of God. And all of us deserve your wrath and punishment for the sins. But Lord, it is because of Jesus Christ that we have peace through faith in him. For Christ died for us while we were still sinners, that we can stand before you and boast in the Lord and serve you wholeheartedly. And so, Lord, help us to receive your grace. God, it is hard for us at times to accept some grace. Lord, many of us want to be in control of ourselves. Many of us, for some reason, don't fully accept your grace and feel like we have to prove ourselves, or feel like that we are responsible for everything that happens in our lives. But Lord, may we rely on your grace and mercy. And in doing so, Lord, may we offer your grace and mercy to those around us as well. Lord, because as we have received forgiveness, so too we forgive others who have sinned against us. And so, Lord, may we be a people of grace, recognizing that we are forgiven. And may we be gracious to those around us as well, to show them grace and love and mercy as you have shown us. And so, Lord, in doing so, may we tackle on all all our adversity, everything in this world, because of your great love shown for us, as your Spirit been poured out for us. And so, God, be with us this week as we live in your grace, as we remind ourselves that we are forgiven through you, that we don't have to prove ourselves anymore, for Christ has proven it to us on the cross. And may we show your grace and love, mercy and fellowship to those around us. In Jesus Christ, our Lord's name we pray. Amen. In response to God, as we heard about the grace and the power of the ministry of what God is doing in our lives, this morning there's a ministry going on at Minnesota West, a new ministry that's been taking place called CREW. CREW used to be Campus Crusades for Christ, and they've been going at the college, I think, for a year or so. This morning we invited Kristen Walerius. She's going to share about the ministry. So I think, Kristen, there she is. So she's going to come up and share what God is doing here locally on the campus of Minnesota West. And looks like she has some more people with her as well. So great.
I'm Peter Schultes. I'm one of the volunteer.
I got you. Mic number two.
There we go.
Thank you.
I'm Peter Schultes. I'm one of the volunteer leaders at Minnesota West CREW.
I'm Ashley Wagner, and I'm one of the student leaders for CREW.
And I'm Kristen Walerius, and I'm another one of the adult volunteer leaders.
So you kind of gave us a little bit of an introduction there, but we are a Christian organization that meets at Minnesota West on campus there. We're connected with the Greater CREW organization, which is a nationwide organization that it exists on campuses to provide a spot for Christians to be able to learn, so students involved in their campuses. And so we're going to talk just a little bit about what we are doing there, and then if you are a high schooler looking at going to college, or if you are already a college student, find us afterwards, or even if you're just interested in learning a little bit more about CREW, be sure to find us afterwards. We'd love to talk to you and try to either help get you connected in with an organization at the campus of your choice, or tell you a little bit more about us. But without further ado, there we go.
So we start meeting at 6 o'clock in the main building at Minnesota West in room 207. And we start with a meal and just kind of hang out and talk and chat about our day. And then we go into a Bible study and we end with prayer at 8 o'clock. And then from 8 to 9, we have after CREW, and it's just a time that we can just fellowship with each other, hang out, play games, and just kind of connect with each other a little bit more.
That's on Mondays.
Oh, yeah, that's Mondays, Monday nights at 6.
So I recently went to CREW's fall retreat about 4 weeks ago, and what happens is campuses around Minnesota come down, and we just worship the Lord all weekend, and what I came home with was many new friends from different campuses.
Anyways, that's a little bit about us. Be sure to find us after the service, but thank you guys for having us.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you guys for coming, and definitely be sure to talk to them after the service, and I'm just excited to see what God's doing on our campuses and colleges and with the gospel. And so during our congregational prayer, we'll be praying for you guys as well here today. So with that, we're going to take this morning's offering, and as we do so, please sign and pass the friendship pads.
Now I'm found, was blind, but
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and mercy given to us in Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for your love, and we thank you for the fellowship that we have as believers in you, that we can gather here today in your presence to give glory to you, to encourage one another, and to share in your gifts. And so, God, we thank you for these gifts that we can offer to you for your church and for your kingdom and sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. May these offerings be representative of our lives, offering ourselves to you in service to you out of the joy it is to serve you. Because, God, you provide for us both physically and spiritually. And so we place our trust and our faith in you. God, you who have created us, you who have redeemed us, and you who sustain us by your Spirit. And so, God, I thank you for our gathering here today. Lord, I thank you for all the churches that are gathering both locally and throughout the world. Lord, we thank you for our guests who are with us today and those who are watching at home, and pray your blessing be upon them. We pray for us as members of your church to continue to grow in your Spirit and grace and fellowship. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. And so, Lord, we lift up in prayer the needs of our congregation. God, we're grateful that Betty Tierink is able to recover from her surgery, and we continue to pray that you be with her on her journey. Lord, we pray for Celia Tierink as she's recovering from her broken wrist, Jim Tierink from his recovery from his shoulder surgery, and Paula Voinitz from her broken wrist as well. Lord, we just pray that you continue to bring healing from their surgeries and from their recoveries, Lord, and God, continue to strengthen them. God, we pray for Vern Fries as he recently suffered a heart attack. I'm grateful that he is doing better. Lord, thank you for watching over him and the care that he received, and just continue to be with him and Sandra as he continues to regain his strength and gets back into his routine. Lord, we continue to pray for Jacoba Nagel's brother, Herm, as he continues to be on his journey, as he's now in intensive care. Lord, we pray for Janine Decker, Lord, as she's been on this journey dealing with cancer, Lord, and I'm sure she is worn out and tired from the day-to-day grind. But Lord, we just pray that you encourage her in your Spirit. And Lord, we just pray that you continue to be upon her and your grace continue to just bless her and anoint her, Lord, as she continues with her journey. Lord, we pray for Ken Zylstra as he continues his treatment for ALS as well. Lord, we want to lift up in prayer Joyce Klossebor as her sister Rosetta Van Marl has recently been placed in hospice care. Just be with Joyce and the family and her husband as well as they go through this time. Lord, we are grateful for her sister's faith. And Lord, may her faith and may the grace of Christ get them through all of this. Lord, I want to lift up in prayer the family of Amy Johnston Campbell. Lord, a former member of our church from many years ago, as she unexpectedly and suddenly passed away this week. Lord, may your peace be upon her husband and the kids and the family, Lord. Lord, as they're going to miss your mom, Lord, I just pray that you be with all her family and friends as well and those who are supporting her. And Lord, may your grace be upon them, Lord. We don't always know why or the circumstances as far as why you allow these things to happen. But God, we do know that you are trustworthy and we put our faith and trust in you. God, we want to lift up in prayer today those who are persecuted throughout the world. We lift up in prayer Christians throughout the world who have shared the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And for whatever reason, Lord, Satan is always at work in this world, and people feel threatened by the gospel, whether it's because we confess Jesus is Lord or to recognize that is by Jesus Christ our sins are forgiven. Whatever it is, Lord, people don't always want to hear the good news. But Lord, we just pray that people are receptive to it. We pray that seeds continue to be planted, and we pray for continued protection for those who are persecuted because of their faith. We think about the Apostle Paul in the New Testament and how he was arrested because people didn't want to hear it, but yet the light of Christ continued to shine in him, in which case he is able to continue to communicate with us as we saw in God's Word today about the hope of the glory in our suffering. Lord, as we pray that here today, we just pray for our communities as well. We thank you for all the other churches and all the organizations and members of the community. Lord, we just pray for the continued harvest this harvest season and pray for safety for everyone. Lord, as people are working long hours and on the road and dealing with big machinery, God, we just thank you how you continue to provide a harvest for us each and every season, especially as late as the planting went this year. But God, we continue to put our trust in you because you had proved yourself faithful time and time again. Lord, we pray now. We thank you for Logan and Ashley Ehlers with their wedding yesterday and pray blessing upon them as well. And Lord, as a church, as we gather here today, as we're going to look at nominations, Lord, as many churches are looking at the year to come, looking at nominations of leadership and congregational meetings and budgets, Lord, we just pray that your spirit and your presence be on all of this, that we as a church continue to follow you faithfully and listen and seek your guidance. And so, God, we thank you for the members of CRU who are with us here today. We thank you for the outreach of their ministry, Lord, and just pray continued blessing upon them. And we're grateful that, God, you continue to minister in new and exciting ways, both in our community and throughout the world. And so, God, we're grateful that they could be with us here today and just continue to bless them as they continue to share Jesus Christ to those who are on the college campus. And so, Lord, we pray now, as we do every week, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen. As we're about to sing our closing hymn, I just want to close with a few announcements. First, you have the inserts for the harvest dinner. That is going to be on Wednesday, November 20th at 6 p.m. It'll be catered event, and there will be an offering taking place. Sign up by November 17. There will be entertainment at this event. The Claussons will be performing, so it'll be a great time of celebration as we do our harvest dinner. Thank you to Kristen Valerius and the rest of your crew. Like how I did that? Yeah, very good. Thank you guys for coming here. We really appreciate not only you coming here, but the ministry that CRU is doing on the campus. It's so important and so grateful for the work that God is doing with you with that. Reminder, there will be no adult Heidelberg Catechism, sorry guys, today, but we have nominations today. Which reminds me, after the service, if members could stick around, we'll briefly pass out the slips. And last but not least, with Logan and Ashley Ehlers' wedding last night, they had extra party mix and cookie cake. And so the party extends this Sunday morning. So after everything else, if you go over in the chapel area, there's some yummy refreshments. So with that, let us close out our service, giving glory to God, singing the closing hymn, Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled.
Grace, grace.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.